Hi, and welcome to Community Hotline at Home. I'm Monica Weitzel. Today we'll be talking with YMCA of Columbia Willamette. The YMCA has been serving the greater Portland area for 151 years as a catalyst for transformational change, fostering relationships, and building thriving, inclusive communities. YMCA has been taking steps to help communities during the pandemic, and we'll take a look at their upcoming programs and offerings for families now that things are starting to open up. With us today is Tyler Wright, the president and CEO of the YMCA Columbia Willamette. Welcome, Tyler. It's good to have you on the show.
Thank you, Monica. Good to see you.
Thank you. You know, the pandemic has affected all nonprofits, and I'm sure it's affected the YMCA. How have you been able to deal with this?
Well, our Y's been in the Portland area for about 151 years. Over the last 20-some years, we actually shifted more to a childcare type of model, providing before and after school and preschool care throughout our entire service area. We're not the traditional YMCA that people think about here in the States. That's a building somewhere where you go to work out. We have three facilities, but we're really more program-based. So we were affected like everyone, especially my colleagues in the Y movement across the country, but not as affected. So we shifted very quickly, or using the cliche word of today, we pivoted very, very quickly to essential childcare and repurposing some of the childcare sites that we either own or lease that are not school-based. And so we're still providing about childcare for about 400 children. Now, it's far less than the 2,700 children that we were providing pre-COVID. But we moved as quickly as we could. We made the painful decisions to put a lock on the doors of the three traditional facilities that we have. But we held on as long as we could. And then we really started looking at partnerships within our particular community. That how can we help? How can we aid and assist? So we've been working with the Red Cross, working with Meals on Wheels. And in Washington County, our Sherwood YMCA facility located in Sherwood was named as an essential hub by the county, where certain necessary supplies for families who have been sheltered can come and pick up, such as food and masks and diapers and things of that nature.
Yeah, you're still providing services, which is really the important part, but you're doing the things that need to be done right now.
Right.
Right.
Yeah. And what we can do.
And what you can do. That's, and you know, if you're providing childcare for 400, well, that's 400 families that don't have to find it elsewhere.
Absolutely. Yeah. And then we also shifted as well to what a lot of YMCAs and fitness centers and clubs are doing. We went right to virtual learning, mm-hmm. and virtual classes. We have about 1,400 people that participate in some sort of virtual class weekly now. And as we begin to emerge from this, we're actually going to continue the virtual learning and virtual classes and make it more of a membership value type ad.
Good. I'm glad to hear that. I think that a lot of organizations are finding out that people are willing to do the virtual learning. I mean, they're coming out in droves to find ways to engage with others and learn from the comfort of their homes. So what are some of the kinds of classes that you offer online?
Oh my goodness. Pretty much the variety of classes that we were offering before COVID. We offer Zumba, yoga, traditional Pilates type classes. We offer small movement type classes for those with some sort of physical ailment or disability. We offer a lot of classes for our aging adults, and we actually offer water type classes as well. Even though you may not be able to get in the water at home, there are still certain activities that you can do from your chair, you know, small movement type classes for those that might be struggling with arthritis or recovery from injury and things of that nature. As we were serving our adult membership, we were also looking about how can we provide opportunities for our kids? Think about what kids are going through right now. They're mm-hmm. sheltered at home. They're distant from their friends. They're doing virtual learnings. Or as one child told me about 3 weeks ago, I'm sick and tired of seeing only my mom and dad. We actually added a menu of classes for kids as well, too, from enrichment type classes to fun arts and crafts type classes to late night, well, late night being 7 o'clock, campfire classes where kids can sit around a TV and go and participate in a campfire type of setting.
Fun. So fun.
Yeah. I'm very excited about that. And the other thing I haven't mentioned, Monica, is that we have a very strong chaplain program here where our chaplains pre-COVID would reach out to our members in a very caring and compassionate type of way and embrace people where they were, whether it be emotionally, spiritually, physically, socially, whatever it might be. And we wanted to make sure we didn't lose that. So we actually have weekly small group sessions with our chaplains, and any member can join for that. And we've seen a rise in those particular classes and meetups, if you will, because people just are so disconnected right now, and they're just yearning for relationships.
That's good to know. People are yearning for relationships, but then again, the ones that are at home all the time with their family, sometimes it's like, I need to talk to somebody else too.
Yeah, exactly, so, right. Exactly.
Sometimes it can be very challenging. So are all your services membership-based? Then if you're a member, you're able to participate in those programs?
They're a membership value add, yes. Okay. But we opened it up to anybody.
You did. That's what I'm wondering. If other people can do that too.
Yeah.
And we can find all that out on the website, I assume.
Yes, please.
Okay, great. I have to ask about the summer camps because I know that's always a big deal. And you've got two beautiful camps out in East County here, one in Mount Hood and one in the Camp Collins, one in Troutdale. Am I right in understanding that you are going to continue with day camps? Is that right?
Yeah, absolutely correct. So our plan is to continue with essential care. We're offering essential care right now at 10 locations across the greater Portland and Vancouver areas. We want to continue that kind of work. We also want to add on a layer of programming, which is our summer day camp programs. And so we'll be offering summer day camp, you know, within the guidelines and protocols of safe practices that the state has issued. We'll be offering summer day camp at 10 different locations as well. Because there are certain limitations that we're going to abide by with stable groups and number of in a stable group, we're not going to be able to provide the type of summer care to all the families that we did, say, pre-COVID, but we'll still be able to provide care for another 400 different families.
That's great.
And those are 10 different locations aside from what we're doing with essential care. And one of our locations is using Camp Collins, which is, I think, one of the camps you were referring to, Monica, where kids are actually going to be experiencing a different type of camping experience. We've got a couple of really exciting sessions where kids are actually going to learn certain wilderness techniques, learning things about the land that they may not have learned before. We don't have the luxury of our ropes course and our horses and a few other activities, and yet we look at that 160 acres of natural playground space and say, how can we utilize this? So our kids are gonna learn things like how to identify certain foods and fruits and vegetables that they can eat if they were in nature, how to build a yurt, how to start a campfire and things of that nature. Very exciting.
They're survival skills too.
I actually wanted to label that, and then I thought, I don't know if that's the right term to say.
But really, they are. Once they know that, I mean, they've learned some survival skills.
I think we're calling it outdoor learning and achievement.
Yeah, sounds good. Sounds good. Well, that's such a great experience. So even if it looks different than it's looked in the past, for the kids that have never experienced a day camp or any kind of camping, that would be huge. I mean, it'd still be, you know. And even if they have, I think it would be a great experience.
We saw this kind of coming. We have a beautiful overnight camp, and we made the painful decision, very painful for us, to not offer overnight camping at the 1st of May. And so then we began to think, well, how can we still connect with our children? Even though we had not heard from our governors about summer day camp, we had assumed that there would be something coming to get kids out of their house to experience outdoors in a safe type of way. So we began to build our day camp program actually throughout the month of May, and we launched registration June 1st. Just within the first week alone, we had over 900 families register for a session camp.
Wow. So do you even have any room left?
Oh, yeah. We're offering. Well, the way we offer day camp is in weekly type session formats. Mm-hmm. So if you think about the 10 weeks of summer that we're offering camp, and we're staggering, by the way, I should say, our first session of camps opens June 15th at certain locations, then June 22nd, and then finally June 29th.
Okay.
And so if you look at say the maximum, a parent can sign up for 10 weeks of camp at a certain location. And we've capped those. We obviously have capped the size of not only our groups, but the capacity of those camps adhering to all of the protocols. So a family like me could sign my two children up for 10 weeks of camp. So what we're seeing is 900 families have signed up for camp. That's not sessional count.
That's a lot. So it could be, yes, they could have signed up for numerous sessions.
Yeah, and there's still plenty of space. Okay. We just got word today, I think, from our governor that we now actually can offer a summer day camp program in parks. So we're quickly pivoting again to say, do we have the staffing ability to maybe offer a day camp program at Jones Park or whatever it might be? So we're actually in conversation with that right now.
Wow. Well, I'm glad you're so agile as an organization that you're able to do that. So that's
Well, I've long since said that the M and YMCA should stand for mobile.
because you are. Yeah. A lot of your programs are not location based, right? They're out in the community. So
right. Absolutely.
Which makes it more accessible for everyone. So yeah. I like that. Is there anything else we need to know about the YMCA of Columbia Willamette?
Yeah, I would love to share the fact that one of the other wonderful successes and blessings that we've had is that a lot of people during this particular time have recognized the work that we've done and have been contributing to our YMCA to sustain what our operational model today. And this mm-hmm. is prior to our facilities open, which two of our facilities will open next week, our Sherwood facility and our facility in Beaverton. And then our Clark County facility will open at the end of the month. But we're so blessed. We've raised over $500,000 just in about a 6 week period of time to fund the operations of today, to keep our staff healthy, to keep our staff employed. And so if those are your viewing audience, your listening audience feels compelled to do so, they could please go to our website. And there's a donate button on our website. If they would love to contribute to not only what we're doing today, but what we're going to be doing through the summer, we'd be incredibly grateful for that.
I would encourage people to do that. There are so many people out there, including myself, who have benefited from the Y at different times of our lives. So, you know, as children and even as adults. And so, yeah, if you have those memories and, you know, whether or not you're involved right now, you know, give some money and keep it going.
I know we're short on time. I wanted to impart just a quick story about that. I live in downtown Portland. Chose to live there because I wanted to really get a breath and a view coming from Los Angeles of what Portland was like. I went walking about 2 weeks ago on a night. This was before the riots and the protests. I went walking and encountered a gentleman who was living on the streets. And he just asked me, do you have a moment to talk? And I said, sure. So we just sat on a curb and we talked literally for an hour and I listened to his story, this outpouring of his emotion. And then he asked me, what do you do? I didn't ask. I said, well, I'm the CEO of the YMCA. And his eyes just lit up. And he said, I grew up in the Y. Look right at me. I'm a Y kid. Wow. And there's so many stories like that here. And I just looked at him. I said, sir, I appreciate that. And you're not forgotten. We're gonna figure out a way for people like yourself that can continually be engaged with this entity, this organization that you have such a passion and fondness for. So. There, I think there are all kinds of stuff.
I love it. Yeah, I'm sure there are. You could fill books, I'm sure. That was moving. That's wonderful to hear. Thank you for all the work that you're doing. I really appreciate it, Tyler, and all your staff and everyone else are keeping it going for us. So have a great summer season, and we'll talk to you later.
Fantastic. Thank you, Monica.
Thank you. And to all of our viewers out there, from all of us at MetroEast, be safe and be healthy.